I believe the day has finally come. We're all starting to act like one, and with one mighty voice together, we will proclaim that Jesus, Jesus Christ is King. And it's gonna echo through this whole earth. It's gonna shake every nation, and the world will see.
You're my brother.
To Riverside Seventh-day Adventist Church, we are glad that you have chosen our church today to listen to the Word of God. We welcome our regular members, those who may have been sick, those who are struggling. We are praying for you. We also thank you for tuning in today. We also welcome our friends from far and near who will be tuning in to listen to the sermon that God has prepared for His children. We trust that you will be blessed, that you will be challenged to live closer to Jesus, and that your relationship with Him will grow deeper as you listen and accept His word and promises in your life. We are living in troublous times, uncertain times. But let's remember that God has carried us thus far by faith, and that He will continue to carry us into the future until the day when He comes. Be blessed as you enjoy this Sabbath program with us.
We're now going to play hymn number 311. Please sing with us.
Thank you.
Good morning, kids, and happy Sabbath. For today's children's story, we will be talking about Abraham and the stars. Have you ever been worried, scared, feeling like you are going to be in trouble, or like nothing is going right for you? Have you ever felt unhappy? The Bible tells us in Genesis 15 that Abraham was not happy because he didn't have a child. But God did something very interesting. He took him outside and said, "Look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them." Then God said to Abraham, "So shall your offspring be." In other words, that's how many descendants Abraham would have. God showed Abraham the stars. I think God showed Abraham something we call perspective. That is a very big word. Do you know what perspective is? Your perspective is the way you see something. Abraham saw that he had a big problem. He didn't have a child. But God made Abraham see the stars. Why did God show Abraham the stars? Well, there were many stars, and God was promising Abraham that he would have many children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. But more importantly, who made the stars? Wasn't it God? If God could make the stars just by speaking, and he created them out of nothing, God is mighty and powerful enough to make Abraham a child out of nothing, and even make him a daddy as an old man and Sarah a mommy when she was an old woman. God showed Abraham the perspective that he is our creator. He created this wonderful earth, and he is mighty, he is powerful, and he is certainly bigger than all the problems causing us to be sad, worried, or scared. If he can create all these things and look after all these things every single day, can you imagine what he can do in your life? Jesus died for us and loves us more than we can ever know. He will help us and he will give us peace. Have faith in God. Trust in him. God's words to Abraham and his words to his disciples are his words to us today. Jesus said, "Have a look at the birds in the sky. They don't plant seeds, they don't bring in harvest, they don't store things in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. How different are you from them? Take a tip from the lilies in the countryside. They don't work and they don't weave." In other words, nature does not worry about these things. God tells us we need to make him and his kingdom and his way of life our way of life, and we need to make it our top priority. God told Abram, and he tells us today, "Do not be afraid. I am your shield, your very great reward." Remember Abraham? He had faith in God and was blessed with Isaac. God gave him an heir even in his old age. God can sort out our problems. We must have faith in him. No problems are too big for him. Let's close our eyes in prayer.
Our Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful, wonderful, good Sabbath day. And also for the nice, lovely story of Abraham. And what it teaches us is when we got a problem, you can fix it. In your name, amen.
Let me tell you something. The practice of tithing has not been a church's invention. As well as the Sabbath, It has been established by God Himself, and it is practiced by all those who recognize Him as the Creator and Provider, and who accept the Bible as His Word. It was by Jesus Christ Himself, who gave His life for the life of the world, that this plan was devised. Abraham paid tithe long before the establishment of the Jewish nation, because instead of being a Jewish institution, tithe was planned to be a blessing to the whole of humanity. When alone, far from home, and with no material support, Jacob also promised to God, "Of all that you give me, I will surely give a tenth to you." As the Israelites were about to be established as a nation, the law of tithing was reaffirmed. "And all tithe of the land is the Lord's. It is holy unto the Lord. And concerning tithe of the herd or the flock, of whatever passes under the rod, the tenth one shall be holy unto the Lord." But how can I know if tithe should really be 10% of all the income or increase? Can I return a different percentage as tithe? Should I return it from my salary only? What about the other incomes? Good questions. The very word tithe is a translation from the Hebrew word maaser, which means a tenth or 10%, which is the same. So, as any percentage different from that cannot be called tithe, it is very important for the believer to regularly verify all the income or increase from any source, recognize it as coming from God, and calculate the exact amount that represents one-tenth of the blessing. Let us follow Solomon's invitation. "Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase, so your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine."
We've no abiding city here, set truth where this to be our home. But let this thought of spirits cheer, we seek a city yet to come. We seek a city yet to come. We've no abiding city here. We seek a city out of sight. Zion its name, the Lord is there. It shines with everlasting light. It shines with everlasting light. But hush, my soul, nor dare repine. The time my God appoints is best. What is to do, His will be mine, and His to fix my time of rest, and His to fix my time of rest.
We've no abiding place.
We've no abiding city.
Hi, friends. It's good to be with you again. Thank you for joining us. And on this great time in Earth's history, I pray that you will be blessed by the Word of God today. And let's bow our heads as we ask the Lord to be with us. And I solicit that you get into a comfortable environment, a quiet environment, so that you can hear the Word of God speak to you clearly. Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord, I thank you for your amazing divine love that speaks the world into existence, that same voice speaks to us today. Where you've spoken, let us hear. But thank you for the vibration that your voice causes, that everything worships you, from the plants to the earth, every living thing declares the glory of the Lord. We thank you for your leading in our lives. We ask you to forgive us if there's anything that has in our hearts or in our lives that should not be there. Remove it. Thank you for your kindness and for hearing this prayer. In Jesus' name I pray that you'll be with your people, save them for your kingdom, accept our worship. Amen and amen. Friends, today I ask you to turn with me to Colossians, that is Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 is our main text. It reads, it says, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for in Him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, invisible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or authorities. All things were created through Him and what? For Him. So even we were created through Him and for Him. He is both all things, and in Him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. So He's both the firstborn of all creation and the firstborn of the dead, that everything He might be preeminent. For in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Him to reconcile Himself to all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of His cross. And so we see that the sacrifice of Jesus allows us then to experience the fullness of God, that He reconciles us, in other words, brings us closer to Himself, brings us to where He is, in the sense of His personal touch, in the sense of we are able to converse with Him in prayer. And I don't think we realize the privilege. Now, the book of Colossians, or Colossia, it wasn't actually the foundation of Paul, but more Epaphras, which we find in chapter 1, verse 7. And Epaphras was a preacher who took the gospel to the city of Colossia, which it seems as though Paul sent him to the city. And Paul could not have been in this very city because he couldn't be everywhere at once. And so Paul takes a key interest in the church in this book or letter, and then he helps them, he instructs them, and he guides them. And so this passage is one of Paul's most profound and most powerful descriptions of the person, namely Jesus Christ. We can't be sure about the exact nature of the false teaching, though, that was going on here at the time, but we realize that the reason why Paul writes these things is because there was a false teaching and a belittling of the person and the work of Jesus Christ. They may have been teaching that He is not fully God. One of the most important early church controversies was over the person of Jesus, of the person of Christ, centered on these verses. And so this guy, whose name was Arius, is one of the early church heretics, and I'm talking about the 1500s, 1600s, 1700s, or when the church was being established all around Europe. and they can do America and spread to the rest of the world. Now, the controversy was that they used this firstborn of all creation, as Colossians, or as Paul writes to the Colossian church on behalf of Epaphras, that they argue that Jesus is the highest created being. So they're arguing that God was not preeminent, that he existed from the very beginning, whatever beginning that is. So they say that he's created and he's not equal with God. That is the argument. But we know as Christians that God existed even from the beginning, and whatever that beginning was, John 1 verse 1. And so the modern followers of Arius, as we know them today, are called the Jehovah's Witnesses. Now, I know you guys know what the Jehovah's Witnesses are, because a friend of mine always used to hide under the table when the Jehovah's Witnesses used to come and visit them, as not to deal with him. And so we know that they are the people that come to your house. But besides that, they discredited Jesus Christ as being God. Now, you can see what the enemy tries to do is to discredit Paul's writings as God being, or Jesus being, preeminent. And they use this verse to pull him down from his rightful place. And so do non-Trinitarians as well. They say that Jesus is the literal Son of God and he was created. And this all sorts of splits starts bring things into the church that should not be there. And I say this confidently, because if we read Colossians, we get at the idea that this God comes down to human beings and comes and becomes one of us. And so in this letter, he explains these things, and you see this conflicts with the rest of the Bible, that Christ thus is now both creator and created and creator. It doesn't make sense. Christ is the creator, and we can see that in John. Now, this, what we see here, is called an apex legomenon, which is a word that only appears once in all of Paul's writings, being this phrase, the firstborn of all creation. So, there was a pianist practicing one day in the great church in Europe, and a man came up to the organ and asked him if he could play. The organist looked at him and thought to himself, I shouldn't let this man play. Just look at him, he's unclean, he's not shaven, he looks like a hobo, etc. But finally the organist let him play, thinking that he couldn't play very long. And after all, what does the hobo know about, like, you know, an organ? And so the stranger plays on and on, but the organist was spellbound, and when the stranger got up to leave, the organist could not contain himself and shouted, "Who are you? What is your name?" And the stranger looks low, like a, you know, like a hobo. He shouts, "Who are you? And what is your name?" He says. So the person that was like a hobo, and that, as the stranger looked at him and wondered who this man is, they found out. He found out that this man's name was Felix Mendelssohn, the famous organist. And so this guy grasped, as he judged him from the outside, not knowing who he really was. And so our text today in Colossians is something similar, that the firstborn of creation is not something that we can really understand. And so we go to a biblical understanding found in the Old Testament. Now, the idea of the firstborn, as understood biblically in the Old Testament, can be found in Genesis 22 verse 20 onward, Genesis 25, 13 onward, and Deuteronomy 21, 15 and onward. The firstborn biblically in the Old Testament was responsible to take care of the younger. Hence, a double portion was as provision to take care of the children. Now, the firstborn in Jewish and Greek Roman world meant rank and supremacy. But for instance, David is called the firstborn, the highest in rank of the kings of the earth. David was not literally the firstborn, but he was the firstborn in terms of priority, in terms of superiority, in terms of rank. And the text Paul is pointing to Jesus' unique relationship to God and to creation. Now, let's look at an example found in the Old Testament, namely Reuben, one of the oldest of the brothers, who was supposed to look after Joseph. But instead of looking after Joseph, he tries to kill his brother and rid him with his other brothers. And so this disqualifies him as the firstborn, and was not trusted with Benjamin, the youngest son that comes after Joseph, the youngest brother. Judah then took over this role of the older brother and played the role so well that no wonder the messianic line found in Matthew chapter 1 and Luke chapter 3, the lineage of the Messiah, no wonder it's found that from the lineage of Judah comes the Messiah. And so because of the faithfulness of Joseph and the unfaithfulness of his eldest brother, Joseph gets a double inheritance. And what happens? Two tribes come from Joseph, namely Manasseh and Ephraim. Now, in Exodus, this talks of a special mention of firstborns. Let's go to Exodus chapter 4, verse 22. Exodus chapter 4, verse 22. Now, notice here that when we look at Exodus 4, verse 22, we'll find that, and you shall say to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, Israel is my first son, my firstborn son. Notice there, Pharaoh, you must tell Pharaoh that Israel, a nation, is my firstborn son. And I say to you, let my son go, that he may serve me. And if you refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay your firstborn son. And we know that the angel of death comes over the nation of Egypt, and the firstborn sons of the Egyptians die, as well as Pharaoh's firstborn son. God is serious about his firstborn. Amen. So then Israel is now named as God's firstborn, chosen, even though they are not the oldest empire. But Egypt was established before them. But that does not mean Israel was the first nation, but they were the first nation in terms of not chronological birth, but chosen by God, meaning the birthright was given to the first child to be born, and not only in terms of time, chronological time, like I'm the firstborn, my sister is the second after me. It doesn't mean in that time, in terms of age. And so we find that the example of Esau, the firstborn, that's how we can understand it a bit better. Esau was the firstborn, but he did not inherit the birthright. But both Esau and Jacob, and so we know that the birthright was passed down. And Reuben was also the firstborn, but he does not receive the birthright because he does not take care of Joseph. For this reason, the birthright goes to the firstborn with the priesthood, and it was lost to Judah and to Levi. Now, Egypt's firstborns were killed. Can it be that the firstborns symbolized a defeat of a whole nation? That the firstborn represents a whole nation? You see, i.e. Satan wanted to kill the whole nation of Israel. And then God intervenes and he kills the Egyptians' firstborns. So when Israel offered the firstborn of the flock to God, it was a representation of the giving of the whole flock, of the whole family. It was representing the firstborn. Now, because of Colossians 1 verse 17, Christ being the firstborn, all things hold together, it says. The first birthright, the birthright of Jesus over creation, takes or makes him creator of the invisible and the invisible. And then we've also read further on that he is also the firstborn from the dead. In other words, Christ as the firstborn from the dead points to his resurrection as the first of his kind. Supreme, so he's supreme over all other resurrections that took place in the Bible. He is the firstborn from the dead. In other words, his resurrection cannot be compared because he had all power. He's both God and human. And he takes on our form so that life can be shown, that there is hope. And so he says that even though that our bodies will rot away, perhaps we'll go to sleep in the grave, but when he comes again, all disease, all aging, all death will be cast away. There won't be that anymore, because he himself, God, will renew, because he is over all death and creation. And so he is not only first in time, this is Jesus, not only first in time, God is first in preeminence. He pre-exists, like he was there from the very beginning till now, and he will be eternity. So he is eternity past, he is eternity present, and his eternity future. He cannot be comprehended as some try to comprehend him. This is why it says in John chapter 11 verse 25 that in him resurrection holds together. I am the resurrection and the life. Both creation, by creation and redemption, by creating us and redeeming us, by making us and from the dead resurrection out of the situation. Isn't that beautiful? Paul wants every Christian, you and me, to know that Jesus Christ is preeminent, superior, stands out. He is above all others. He is preeminent over natural creation and the universe. He is preeminent over spiritual creation. The church, God's purpose is that he himself will come to have first place over everything. Listen to Colossians chapter 1, Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. Now it says that in 18, he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, he is the firstborn from the dead, and everything he might be preeminent, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And so we find here that God wants to be over everything in your life. Now the question to you and to me today is God over everything in your life? Does God have first place in your life? If he is both creator and redeemer, sustainer and maker, does he have first place over your life today? Does he have first place over your words? Does he have first place over your time that you use? Does he have first place over your finances? Are you a firstborn? God wants you to be a firstborn, to inherit the kingdom, because he was the firstborn of all creation, and he makes us a son of his, and automatically we become partakers and firstborns of him. You see, there are three implications that this is telling us, three things that this text is trying to give to us, and that is that this world was not made by accident. Some try to argue that this world came into existence by some maker and by an explosion or whatever. But we can clearly see that the intelligent designer designed this world. It was not a cosmic accident. And look, if you have any doubt, just look at your body. Look at the intricacies. Look at the uniqueness and complexity of your DNA. Look at how you made up. Do you really think you're there by accident? I want to tell you today that God has made you, and with a purpose. He has a plan. And that divine plan is playing out if you allow him and you reach out to him in faith. And so it takes more than just a belief, but actual trust that God is the creator of this world. The second thing it tells us is that if God made us, we can trust that he will remake us. In other words, that he will remake this person. Some people who resist committing their life to God because they're afraid that if something changes, that it will take place in their life, that it will infringe on their lifestyle. You see, you hear it so much, like, I don't want to become close to God because then I'll be all holy and stuff. And that's not the idea. I don't want to become a follower of Jesus because it will mean that I will no longer have fun. That is not the whole idea. The idea is that God remakes you into his image, that character that will represent and be like his. The other thing, and so by the way, when you're sick, do you dread going to the doctor when you're sick? Do you moan when you say, I don't want to go to the doctor because I have gotten used to being sick and the doctor might help me to get better? Or I don't want to go to the doctor because if he makes me better, I won't have anything to complain about anymore? No, we don't say stuff like that. We go to the doctor because we know that we need help, and the doctor is trained in what he can do, and he knows the best. It is the same with God. Why do we doubt God's intervention in our lives when he is there? You see, he knows us. It tells me that God knows us. If he is the creator, no one knows better than he does, because he has designed us. No one understands a child better than the parent. No one understands the world better than Jesus. So you see, there's no negative to the fact that God knows us. He knows our failures. We spend a good time, a portion of time, trying to cover up our failures, our sins. But the thing is, God can see it. He knows it. The fact is, are you giving everything back to him? Are you saying, but this is who I am, God. Only you can change me. Only you can make me into what you need me to be. The consequences of our fears and insecurities and failures are there. But you see, God accepts us as we are. God already knows the truth. It is no use hiding it from him. Isaiah 6 says, woe is me, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among people of unclean lips. Isaiah was sure that in this world of sin, that perhaps he could be destroyed, but the hope, our hope, is that when Jesus says that he is over all things over all things and both invisible and visible, when he says that, You see, there's no shady business deal that he doesn't know about. There's no secret thought that he doesn't know. He knows our secrets that we try to hide so vigorously and in the depth of our heart. And he only, simply wants you to leave it with him. I feel like that's so simple, but it is that simple. We overcomplicate our religion at times. But it's, at the same time, it's wonderful. It's wonderful to know a God that really knows us, because we realize that someone really cares about us. And so for the first time then, I can be completely honest with someone. I don't have to pretend like someone that I don't know, or pretend to want to forgive, or pretend to... You see, this God is so... want to be so intimately involved in our lives and our feelings, and yet we don't give him the space to do so. He knows better than we can, that we do. And he knows that what we can become in him. We all have hopes and dreams for our lives, but God knows the purpose for which he has designed you. He knows what he can do through your talents, through your abilities, through your yeses and your noes, your scars. I admire those who can go into a furniture shop and who restores this old piece of furniture to become a masterpiece. These people strip the paint, they repair the damage, they glue the joints, and they transform this thing to be a masterpiece. You see, and that is what God does for us. That's the way it is with God. He knows where we have chunks out of our spirit. The bad thing that has happened in our lives, he knows that thing. Sometimes because of sin, this world, he can't always jump into the situation. We don't always allow him to jump into the situation. He's the masterpiece that he created. It's you and me. And yes, we don't always know that thing, if what would have happened if we didn't go through this tragedy in our lives, or this happy thing in our lives. But God sees the end. He knows that if we had to go through this thing, if we would have been saved or not. And sometimes we doubt that. You see, let me share with you a poem. It says that it was battered. It was scarred. The auctioneer thought it scarcely worthwhile to waste such time on this old violin. But he held it up with a smile and he said, "What I am bidden, good folks," he cried, "who'll start the bidding for me? $1, $2, $2, $3, $3, we'll make it $4. $3 once, $3 twice, gone for three, but no." From the room on the back, a grey-haired man came forward and picked up the bow. Then he wiped the dust from the old violin and he tightened up the tight strings. He played a melody pure and sweet as angels sing. The music ceased and the auctioneer with a loud voice was quiet and low. He said, "What am I bid for this old violin?" And he held it up with a bow. $1,000. We'll make it two. $2,000. We'll make it three. $3,000 going once. $3,000 going twice. Gone, he said. The people cheered, but some cried, "We don't understand. Why did the price go up so much?" The reply came back, a touch of the master's hand. And many a man goes in there through their life out of tune, tattered and torn, broken and with sin, and is auctioned cheap to a thoughtless crowd, much like this old violin. A mess of pottage, a glass of wine, a game he travels on. He gets drunk, he squanders his life. He goes once, he goes twice, his going is almost gone. But wait, the master comes. That is God, friends. He comes into our life and the foolish crowd, they question, they never could understand the worth of a soul, the worth of a soul, and the change that's wrought by the touch of the Master's hand. Friends, we are in God's hand. We are the masterpiece that God is working on in our character and in our lives. We don't always see as God can see. It's got 20/20 vision. But I always say this, it always helps to follow the one who knows where he's going. God knows where he's taking us to. I'd rather follow him. And so I trust him even when there's hurt, even when there's pain, even when things seem difficult. It is him in his whose hands I am that makes the difference. And so friends, he sees what others do not. He knows with a touch of his grace, the work of his spirit, what you can be as this new person. May God bless you and know that he wants to make you a new person. Have a great and successful week. You want to make us this masterpiece, and only we just need to let you just let go and say, God, here I am, here's my heart, this is my life. It's been a mess at times. I don't know how to go on from here, but I trust you. I trust you to make me whole again, because the situations of life have hurt me and I don't know what's coming next, but I know that when I'm with you, I can sail through the storms of life. Lord, We thank you that you are the firstborn of creation, the one who is the creator and the sustainer, the creator and the resurrection from the dead. We love you and we praise you that you will give us new life when you come again. And now, Lord, be with all the people listening, and may they accept your love. In Jesus' name pray. Amen.